Jackson, Montgomery. And in Montgomery, we go to the Legacy Museum and the Lansing Memorial, created by the Equal Justice Initiative. It's not something that you could prepare for, ever. But again, I always knew that all of family came from Alabama, that they were from Montgomery. Some of them, you know, before Montgomery were in Baltimore and Virginia. But when I got to Montgomery, I realized why. I hadn't known why. So for me, again, like, I've been ignorant of historical facts and events earlier on in my years. I'm looking at genealogical records like, oh, you know, third great granny up and moved from Baltimore to Montgomery, Alabama. That's interesting. I didn't know that it was like domestic slavery. Here, there's a legacy museum that talks about how the Montgomery slave trade was basically the epicenter of the domestic slave trade, and I'm not sure on all of the numbers, but there was this image, there was this graphic that basically showed, you know, like large concentrations of people being shipped and sold and pulled and concentrated into Montgomery, and I was like, oh my god. I knew that was from Montgomery, but I didn't know why. And so that was a very visceral experience even prior to entering the museum. Like, that was just the waiting room. that was just the waiting room. And so the Lynch Memorial, which is just basically like down the street from the Legacy Museum, was another experience. And so they have these columns that have county names and victims of lynchings. And so I'm walking through, and you know, you see these columns. I'm looking for Kentucky, right? Because that I'm familiar with. And so maybe like a few columns in, I get to this first one here from Lenoke County, Arkansas, and I saw my name. And so if you probably can't see it, but maybe the fourth name down is a Thomas Humphreys. And so I don't know who Thomas was. I can't verify if Thomas was a blood relative. That doesn't matter anyway. I saw my name and I wasn't ready. And so in a way, I wouldn't say that I felt like I had been a victim of a lynching, but I felt something. And so you see me standing there. That was after I had fell down sobbing. The next picture is me, you know, glancing over the Alabama River current, a marker of the Montgomery slave trade. That's me and my friend Sada. And the bottom is kind of blurry, but as I was like walking through the little area, taking a picture, somebody said, "Can I get that picture?" And I turned around and it was somebody that I knew. Who actually, I ended up staying with her when I went on my next adventure in New York. Montgomery, Alabama. So as I was sitting, about to leave the lynching memorial, I remember something. I remember that my great-grandfather owned a gun store in Montgomery, Alabama in the late 1800s, early 1900s. My great-grandfather was not a black man. Obviously, owning a gun in the middle of downtown Montgomery in the late 1800s and early 1900s. And so for me, that had always been something that I sort of like, you know, kicked to the side, ignored, want to just like, I don't want to deal with that at all. But something said, you know what, you know, look up his name. I wanted to go further down to where my other family was from. But I typed in his name, typed in the gun store, and I get a newsletter from 2011 on Facebook from the local historical society. And I give them a call, they're closing for the day, and the next day, I'm taking a Greyhound back to Cincinnati, and they call me in the morning, and they're like, "Hey, we got this newsletter, we could send it to you in the mail." And I was like, "This is downtown Montgomery, it's this little, I'll be right there." as I'm walking, I'm just like not expecting anything. And so I go inside and I meet this lady and we're chit-chatting. Well, you can already see the gun, but we're chit-chatting and she gives me the newsletter that she can see there. And she's like, actually, I think we have the gun. You know, I'm thinking she's going to show me like an old pistol or rifle. But next thing you know, I'm sitting next to like the 14-foot gun right there, right? But again, I had just decided to go to Mississippi like 3 days before I went down there. And I had set an intention to go to Alabama, didn't know I was going to go. And then this gun just like kind of popped out of nowhere. And I was like, what is going on? This is crazy. So that's the street named after my second great grandfather. So the line of gunsmiths. So that one, he was a Confederate in the arsenal in Austin, Texas. Really fun legacy, right? I could try to see if I can get like an NRA or something. But that was another experience that, again, I was not checking for any of this stuff at all. And so I'll go back because I don't just like stay on the road all the time. I do kind of come back and come back home. I'll stay here for a bit, but during this process, I was working on this performance piece that was going to be like a public performance, you know, site-specific public performances and public space in Cincinnati, Kentucky, memorializing Anson Allen stuff. And so I knew that with this work, I was entering a space and I was going to take on an artist's name. And I was like, I don't know, Oshun, you know, you throw in like your grandma's name, like how the like indie band, something that doesn't take the indie rock band generator name thing, where it's like grandma's name, like something random in macaroni, like, yeah. And so, and then I was like, okay, JC Free. And I was like, that sounds cool, but like F-R-E-E, because like Free rhymes with JC, it goes. And over the months, like, I can't really remember this, like, progression, but I was like, okay, JC Free, and I was like, Free rhymes with Humphreys. I was like, oh, shoot, like, Free is in Humphreys, mind blown, right? And so a lot of us, like, you know, we're growing up in school, we have, like, different, you know, nicknames, you know, the first letter, last little bit of your last name. So I've been J-Hump, I've been Humpty. You know, like when you're little, it's like you might get occasional hump with Free, whatever. But like, never did I ever see Free in it. Right? Like, I never saw it. I was just like, how did I never see this? And so, you know, I tried JC and then PHRIE, and I was like, I could drop the JC. And I was talking to somebody, again, this was just going to be an artist name. Again, I was entering the space. And then one of my friends was like, well, how are you going to spell it? Because I was just going to spell it F-R-E-E. And then I was like, you know what? I can just do the P-H-R-I-E because I was worried about whether or not people would be able to pronounce it, if they would ask questions, or if it would just mess up things. And then also the fact that like, I do it lowercase. It's just things. I was like, worried about what people would, if it would be inconvenient. Or make people uncomfortable if I chose that spelling. And I tried it out here and there, told some people about it, but I wasn't like trying to go by it like, you know, every day until I got here. But before that, so I go to a lot of conferences. So went to Mississippi for a conference and I went to New York for a conference. But like, you know how when you play a video game or something, you have like side missions. That's what I do. I do side missions all the time, clearly. And so, I'll show you as a video. So with New York, I learned that my ancestors, the white ones from Montgomery, they came from New York, which isn't really something that you like, you don't typically associate the Deep South with the North and in that way. Or at least I didn't. Because another image that I always remember was like, you know, when you grow up, I don't know how everybody learns about slavery, but I feel like the way that it's told is as if like plantations just existed. Like, that's where the story starts. And plantations are just these things that have like always been. And there's just people on them. But like, people move. Like, they come from places, right? And so one of those places is the Hudson Valley. And so, I'm not gonna go too far into this story here, but some of those ancestors, I can go back, so I have the image here. And so, for me, this is my, like, direct paternal line. So, my dad's followed dad, right? And so, I trace myself to 1590 Amsterdam. Something that I could never do with my direct, you know, black ancestors. I don't, like, I can't get past 1860 for reasons, right? But with this, it has been really interesting. And I'm so grateful for this experience. But some of my ancestors were slave owners in New York, right? Which is another place that we typically don't associate with slavery, but that's actually where, you know, a lot of the slavery started, but they then, you know, outlawed it and made it a Southern thing, right? But as I was reading the documents, I saw that there was an enslaved boy who basically burned down a barn on my ancestor's property, right? And what I noticed was that it was the officials of, you know, it was the Dutchess County officials who carried out his murder and not my ancestor, my Stoutenburg ancestor, right? And so, you know, it made me think about this history of state-sanctioned violence, right? And so, like, the county can do it. Why can't you do it yourself, right? I said, wow, like, that's crazy. But also, there was this really warped thing that happened because, can we all agree that race is a social construct? Race should never make sense, ever. Like, it should not make sense. And so this was one of these things that made no sense. And so I'm looking, a black woman in 2019, at the time, you know, reading these documents, and I'm seeing the situation play out, right? And so for me, I'm looking, trying to see here, right? So here's me, and I'm like reaching into the 1700s, 1800s, and I see my white slave owning